Good morning, everyone. So I got quiet. I guess it's time to start then, right? Usually we have to quiet everyone down and say, no, it's time to start. But good morning, everyone. Welcome to Yates Baptist Church. So we have a lot of things going on today. It's going to be an exciting day. Baby's getting dedicated. We have some special speakers, but we have Pastor here as well. Everyone's here. This is going to be a great time today. I'm excited about that. But one thing I was going to say is, I'm starting out today. I'll be heading up to the junior church. For junior church, one of the things we're learning about today is Zephaniah. So this is an honesty check. When's the last time we read Zephaniah, huh? I said it's only a few chapters, but one of the things that I was thinking about today was, I actually was in preparing for that, I'm going to start out with this one. This is actually in Zephaniah 3, 8 and following. And it says, "Therefore wait for me, says the Lord, unto the day I rise up for a plunder. My determination is to gather the nations to my assembly of kingdoms, to pour out on them my fierce indignation, all my fierce anger. All the earth shall be devoured with the fire of my jealousy." Like, it starts out, that's condemnation. That's some terrible things going on. But in verse 9, "For then I will restore to the peoples a pure language, that they may all call on the name of the Lord to serve him with one accord. From beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, my worshipers, the daughters of my dispersed ones, shall bring forth my offering. In that day you shall not be shamed for any of your deeds in which you transgress against me. For then I will take away from your midst those who rejoice in your pride, and you shall no longer be haughty in my holy mountain." So there's this future coming time, even after all the judgment, all that, where God will what? Restore a people unto himself in humility. And I said, speaking a pure language and one language altogether, I've told you this before, when we sing, we hear a song, we like these songs, we hear these worship songs, we love them, but I'm always like, there's one more out there, there's one. And I said, I'm always waiting for that song, the new song that we'll sing with him in heaven forever. I said, that one's going to fulfill all of our needs. That one's going to be the one we say, yep, Lord, this is it. This is the song that we're singing to you. So I look forward to that day. So let's open up in prayer. Lord, we do thank you. We do thank you that we can call upon you. Lord, we just want to lift up holy hands, Lord, just pure hearts to you. Lord, we look forward to that day where we can speak together in fellowship, Lord, with one voice, with one song, Lord, one language. We know that you'll gather your people together and that we will worship you forever, Lord. And it's not because of our goodness we've done this. It's not that you've gathered us because we're so bright or so endearing, Lord. But it's for your great name's sake that you've done these things, Lord, that we can be a humble people, not haughty, but a humble people that are just reflecting your glory, thankful for the good things you've done for us. And Lord, as we have the service today, may your word enter our hearts. May we not be forgetful hearers, but doers of the word. Lord, may we be people that love you with our whole hearts, our whole lives long. May we love those around us as well, Lord, as you've loved us. Just pray for the speakers today. Pray for the musicians. Pray for all the folks helping out today, Lord. May you give them an extra blessing of grace, Lord. But may all of us come together in worship of you. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, this morning we have something special. We actually have a responsive reading. So we're going to need you guys to stand and turn your hymnals to 127. Now this one's a little bit tricky because there is the worship leader, everyone, and then the men and women. So you have to follow along. Let's try not to get this too confused here. But in 127, it's a responsive reading, and then right after that we'll go right into the hymn 128. "For the Lord reigns, he is robed in majesty.
The Lord is robed in majesty and armed with strength.
The world is firmly established.
It cannot be moved. Your throne was established long ago. You are from all eternity.
The seas have lifted up, O Lord.
The seas have lifted up their voice.
The seas have lifted up their pounding waves.
Mightier than the thunder of the great waters.
Mightier than the breakers of the sea.
The Lord on high is mighty.
Your statutes stand firm.
Holiness adorns your house for endless days, O Lord.
The Lord on high is mighty."
Amen?
Amen.
Now let's stand and sing number 128.
Mm-hmm. mention that we have Sunday school following the morning service after a little break time upstairs, so please keep that in mind. Next Sunday will be our annual business meeting of the church, and that'll be at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. There'll be a luncheon, and I think there's sign-up sheets on clipboards to be passed around, Levi. So check that out if you can come and bring a dish to pass. And also, we did want to mention the postings that have been put on the metal doors out this way. All the information that you need to know in preparation for the annual meeting is there. So look it over carefully. Many thanks to all who've donated reports and get everything run off. And with God's help, we will do all right. So many, many thanks. I want to mention this Tuesday night at 7:30, the search committee meeting will be held in the library, and we do have a potential candidate for associate pastor here. His initials are MM, and it's not Mike Moomau. I thought I'd give you a clue. Mike is busy down in Oakfield helping out Genesee Country Church. It's our own Mike Minor. Amen? And we would like to appoint the man that God would raise up. And we are thrilled to be able to interview and talk with Mike a little further and see how God leads with all this. So do pray for that Tuesday night, okay? And we want to mention also that there will be family night. We'll try again this week. We had to cancel this last Wednesday, but we will try again February 1st, the Men's Discipleship Thursday night with Dr. David Jeremiah. So, guys, please keep that in mind as well.
All right.
Okay. Pray for the Smiths. Sounds like that unruly neighbor COVID came back to visit. And so they've been hit with that, Jeff and Shelley, Joe and Julianne and the family. We miss them, but pray that they'll be able to return soon. Okay? Mike's going to do the scripture reading.
We are excited to have Mark Scofill with us this morning. And I said the passage that he asked us to read would be in Ephesians 2, 4 through 10. So if we all stand, we'll read together. So here is the word of the Lord. But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up together, and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show his exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them.
Could not express
another announcement. Next week, we're going to have a testimony time. We'd like to do this once a month, and we're going to start on Communion Sunday. We'll see how that goes. I know it might cut the sermon a little short. Kind of limit it to 4 to 6 minutes, something like that. And I got to thinking at that time, if you were kind of been planting some seeds in somebody's heart, that personal testimony, you're going to put as much into their heart in that short time as they'll need to really think about what the Holy Spirit has done to you and can do to them. Now, we've already had our first testimony of the year happen 2 weeks ago. Little Charlotte Minor came up and said, "I want to be baptized." And I've been watching her. Sometimes she comes up here and sits with her friends. And when we sing to start the service, her heart and mind was focused on it. I knew that she was close. Bless you guys. But anyway, we want to get you to know some of the officers. And after we had maybe one from the deacons, one from the trustees, and one from the mission board, we'd like to have some people from the, that are not officers come and share too. It's interesting how the Holy Spirit works differently with most of us, meets us where our need is. And I've had this on my heart for some time. Patty also, Patty of course has been wanting to do this, but I think on a smaller group, which is easier for somebody to give the testimony in a small group. And we're going to start next week. I asked the deacon board who wants to volunteer first, and Mike said, "Yeah, I'll do it first." So, but I 4 to 6 minutes is enough, Mike.
For our dad, happy birthday, Dad. We love
you. Haven't heard her sing yet.
Yeah.
say my mom, she's gone now, but my mom used to say when we were younger, I just want my kids to be happy. But then I had a friend, Brian Stickler, said, you know, I think there's something better than that. I want my kids to be godly and to love the Lord. And Scott, what a blessing to have your kids serving. Amen? Yeah, praise the Lord. Okay, so we're going to have the ushers come forward, and we'll wait upon you for the morning tithes and offerings.
Before we sing another hymn, we are thrilled to have the Driesel family with us. So if Carl and Rachel could come to the front with their two little boys. We dedicated little May Lou to Jesus and she came to church. Good to have all of you here. Good to have the Atwater family. Mark is somehow connected to the Atwaters. And so Mark will be coming and sharing God's word. But in the meantime, we're thrilled to have Carl and Rachel coming, little Joseph and little Luke. And it's a wonder he doesn't wear a stethoscope around, you know, beloved physician. Amen. Carl and Rachel, it's a real joy to have this part in the service with you folks. We've appreciated your involvement. We're thrilled that your little boys are in a Christian home. And as we go along, we find that's one thing we should never take for granted. Amen? That we can be born into a home with loving Christian parents who not only love the children, but teach them, instruct them, and show them the way. And so I thought of Psalm 127 where David wrote, "Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it." And the Bible goes on to say in that psalm, "Behold, children are a heritage from the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward." That adds special blessing, doesn't it? God has rewarded you twice over with beautiful sons. So do you, Carl and Rachel, desire that your children, Joseph and Luke, come to know Christ as their Savior and to live for Christ throughout their lives? Amen. Is it your purpose to bring these children up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord and to teach them reverence for God? Amen. Will you pray earnestly for your children and seek to live an exemplary Christian life before them? Amen. With these resolutions in mind, do you now present Joseph and Luke unto the Lord for God's glory and for the life and service which God would direct?
Yes.
Amen. And now as you dedicate your children today, do you dedicate yourselves to God for this task and for his help?
Yes, we do.
You see, this is important, and baby dedication is to dedicate mom and dad to the Lord in this critical role as parents. What a responsibility. God has entrusted us. It's kind of nice to think that God can trust us. Isn't that nice? Just that alone is rather startling and amazing. God can trust us to rear our children the way He would have it done. And so, as far as you as the congregation, will each of you resolve to pray for the Driesel family and stand behind them in Christian love? All right. I think they meant that. They look in earnest. So you have the full love and support of God and the full love and support from your church family here at Yates. I'd like to offer a special prayer of dedication for the little boys today. Father, for Joseph and for Luke, we are just so thankful that you have given them this blessed gift and this heavenly reward of children. Help Carl and Rachel as they seek to serve you and do what you'd have them to do. Give them clear direction, wisdom, even in the trials of life that are sure to come, days of challenge, days when our faith is tested. Father, we dedicate these little boys to you. And as little Samuel was dedicated so long ago, even so this morning we dedicate these precious boys to Christ. And Lord, that you take them and enable them to grow and to be nurtured and to be serving you in the way you'd have them to serve. Thank you, Father, for these precious little lives. And we, Lord, turn them over to you and realize that you've lent them to us. We lend them back to you. And so now thank you for the Driesels and encourage them in this all-important task. For Jesus' sake, amen. All right. Could be trouble. What a thrill. We'd like to do this right along. So if we have a busy nursery, we can keep right on doing this Sunday by Sunday. But what a joy. Let's turn to hymn number 90. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. Number 90.
Thank you.
joy of the Lord is our strength, and we're so thankful for the joy of the Lord, which can be ours in Christ. We are thrilled to have Mark Scofill with us, a busy itinerary preaching all over the country. Not yet. But Mark, we have just so enjoyed Mark and Bessie and the family, and very active at Ridgewood Bible Church, and I hope they don't miss you too much this morning, bud. But we are thrilled to have you come and share God's word with us, Mark.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you very much. Pleasure to be here. Thank you very much. Well, thank you very much. As I've told Pastor and my father-in-law, Norm, it's a pleasure and a genuine a joy and a privilege to be invited to open God's Word with anybody. I truly love to share Scripture with anybody that will listen to me. And I guess that includes you today, so if I might assume some things, but it is a pleasure to be here. And I'm going to be working through a few verses from Philippians chapters 1 and 2. So if you'd like to turn to Philippians 1 and 2. As is my habit, I know we've prayed quite a bit, but I'm going to ask the Lord to bless his word in our hearts today. Father God, I thank you, Lord, for your word, which is miraculous to us. Lord, it is one of the miracles that not only have you created us and then redeemed us through Christ, but you have left a record with us that we might know how to live well, that we might know how to live in a manner that glorifies you and is good for us. So, Lord, I pray that you would bless your word, bless my heart and the hearts of my listeners, my brothers and sisters in Christ here, Lord. Wherever your word goes out, Lord, we pray that you would do the work in our hearts that you seek to do, that you would find no hard hearts, and that the roadblocks would be put away, and that, Heavenly Father, we would be receptive to what your Spirit teaches us today. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So I'm going to read through a few verses here. I'm not reading through all of Philippians 1 and 2, each and every verse, but I'm going to jump a little bit. In verse 3, I'll start. It says this: I thank God in all my remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you, all making my prayer with joy, because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. And I am sure of this, in verse 6, I am sure of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. Verse 9, goes on to say, and it is my prayer that your love may abound more and more with knowledge and all discernment, that you may approve what is excellent, and so be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God. Jumping down to verse 19, he says, for I know that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this will turn out for my deliverance. He goes on later to say in verse 22, if I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. Paul does not know whether it is better to die and be with the Lord Jesus Christ or whether it is better to live on. And he says that if I live on, it will mean fruitful labor. That phrase, fruitful labor, means work. It means that he's got a mission and he's not sure he's done with it yet. And he is aware that it might be a very good thing. Even though the other choice or place is to be in heaven with God Almighty, the other good thing would be more fruitful labor, more work here. Chapter 2, verse 4. Zip over to chapter 2, verse 4. And he says this: let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, referring to Jesus Christ, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but But he emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. The title of my sermon today, the title of the message that I want to bring to you, is Masterpiece by Design, Workman by Choice. Masterpiece by Design, Workman by Choice. And there's a duality to this. And I ended on that verse that talks about Jesus Christ, because there's a dual nature to Jesus Christ, and it's somewhat mysterious. It's easy to say it and to say that we understand it, but to truly comprehend it seems contradictory. And that is that Jesus Christ was 100% man, but he was at the same time and always 100% God. Man and God are two different things. Never forget that. So to be 100% one of them, at the same time 100% another of them, flies in the face of all we know to be logical. But that's okay, because we're talking about God. What I see in Philippians, though, and even nested in some of the verses that I've read to you, is another seeming conflict, a seeming contradiction. It has to do with work. So I'm here today to talk to you about work and who does it and who's responsible for it. Talking about the works of the heart and the actual works of the hands, both figuratively and literal. Here's the big idea, if you will, my thesis for the day. We must trust God for his work in our lives. We must also be at work in our lives. We must trust God for his work in our lives. We must also be at work in our own lives. We must embrace both of those realities. You see, when we fly to extremes in anything, whether it be education, knowledge seeking, theology, sports, when you fly to one extreme or the other, you often miss the middle. And in the middle is where most of everything lay. The extremes are just a point. Right here is where the truth is. And the fact is that God has done all the work and continues to work in and through us. The other truth is that we must work, and there's work for us to do. And if you forget either one of those extremes, you miss the middle. You can't live here, and you can't live here. And that's my thesis for you today. Some people see this as a conflict, and I'm going to hopefully persuade you to think that it's not really a conflict. It's more the miracle of God in the way he's chosen to work. As much a miracle as what we see in Christ, 100% man, 100% God, come down here to serve us, die for us, raise himself again, and offer us eternity with himself. That's a miracle. So is the work you and I are called to do each and every day. It's miraculous in nature. Think with me about this. God calls people to partner with him. Yes? We have Noah, who was told to build an ark. We have Moses, who was told, go rescue my people. We have David, who was told, slay the giant. We have the disciples, to whom Jesus said, follow me. Now, in all these cases, one extreme might say, well, God did all of that. In another case, somebody might say, well, no, the men did it. Noah built that ark. And I think it's pretty easy to see that it was a cooperative effort. None of those men did anything without God's help. Without God in it, nothing good would happen. There's no chance that Noah builds that ark without first God telling him to, and then without God's empowerment. David does not kill Goliath in his own strength. Nothing could be clearer, which is why I believe that God in his wisdom chose David to do that task. It's all God, yes. But these men, and many of the women in the Bible, responded to God and stepped out in faith, and they did work. They did what needed to be done. Who of us would sit and say that Noah did no work? I'm told that it took 100 years to build the ark. I can't build a... Oh, I'm not going to go through the list. Anybody that knows me understands I have a hard time finishing projects. Noah built an ark and then stuck all the animals on it and floated around for a very long time. The picture is clear. He worked. David worked as the king of Israel, way beyond slaying a giant. But they were empowered by God. So let's take a look first at what we must trust God to do, his work, God's work. We are God's masterpiece, and he does all the work. Here's a real quick view of what happened. You ready? All right, follow me. I'm going to preach the entire Bible to you. Here it is. God created us to live with him forever in harmony and to serve him. We sinned, turned our backs on God, causing a separation forever. God is holy and will not fellowship with sin. Then God redeemed us from eternal separation from him because he's holy and loves us. He took care of our sin through Jesus Christ. He offers that gift of relationship with everybody who would accept it through Jesus Christ. God then grows us, trains us, and shapes us into the image of his dear son, Jesus Christ, eventually taking us home to live with him forever in heaven. That, my friends, is the story of the Bible. I'm done, Pastor. Well, right, I heard that 4 to 6 minutes, and I got a little confused. It's 4 to 6 minutes, the time for the sermon or the testimonies. Anyway, so God creates us for this relationship, and we broke that, we messed it up, and he redeems us. This is work he does. I want to encourage us, and I have to remind us, because here's what happens. We get very confused as humans, as people. We look at extremes, as I've said, and we get confused. We get confused even furthermore because we're 2,000 to 4,000 years, depending on which book of the Bible you're looking at, after this was written in another language and in another time and culture. And so part of this is the difficulty of translation, right? So we wrestle with these things. But let me make this very clear. Salvation is God's work alone. All right, salvation is God's work alone. So Ephesians 2, 8, and 9, which you heard read earlier, says this, by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing. It's the gift of God, lest anyone should boast, not a result of works. But our culture fights against that. We don't like being told that there's no work to do, right? It's not a popular thing. You may have heard expressions like this, there's no such thing as a free lunch. Or how about, if it sounds good, too good to be true, it probably is. How about, nothing is as simple as it seems. Or, you get what you work for. Unfortunately, in today's Christian culture, there's this thought out there that's been labeled easy believism. And there's some men in the church that I respect that have much good to share out of God's word that subscribe to this idea that you can't just utter a prayer and be saved. That somehow there has to be more to it than that. Max Lucado, who does not agree with this thought, says this, and I quote, Jesus' invitation seems too simple. We gravitate to other verbs. Work has a better ring to it. Whoever works for him will be saved. Satisfy fits nicely. Whoever satisfies him will be saved. But believe? Shouldn't I do more? End quote. God did the work of salvation that we cannot do and do not have to do. And my brothers and sisters, I call you brothers and sisters because that's what the Bible refers to about people who have a like belief and trust in Jesus Christ. But let me ask you this. If you are here with us today and have not put your trust and faith in Jesus Christ, I implore you to do that. Do that even now. You have my permission and blessing to drown my voice out. All right? Do business with God. God says it's this simple. Jesus Christ died for your sin and rose again. That's the gospel. How I might explain it is to simply say this. You have to understand you need a Savior because God is holy and you're not. You have sin. Because of that, you need a Savior. And that Savior is only Jesus Christ. God in the flesh who gave his... God loves you so much, he gave his life for you. If you reject that, there's no other way. You'll be separated from him for eternity. But he asks you to accept his love and his sacrifice. So you trust Jesus Christ to forgive you of your sins. You believe in him for eternal life. And the Bible makes it clear you are saved. That's it. And that can happen right now in the truth of your heart between you and God. And I invite you to make that decision. Once that decision is made, what the Bible teaches us is that we're a part of God's family. And this is God we're talking about. He loves us dearly. I'm going to read through some verses here about God's love for us. Once we're a part of God's family by salvation, which is all his work, here's what the Bible has to say. Just a few verses here. I've got them here. I'll read through them. Romans 8:15 says, you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. And that term Abba is kind of like a term of endearment. It's like our modern way of saying daddy or dad. It's a close intimacy. Romans 8:38 says this, "For I am sure that neither death nor life nor angels nor rulers nor things present nor things to come nor powers nor height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord." Nothing. Once we're a part of God's family by his work of salvation. That's Paul's very Holy Spirit-led, poetic, beautiful way of saying nothing can separate us from the love of God. 1 Peter 2:10 says this, it calls us a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Think with me with the lineup here. We are adopted into his forever family. Nothing can separate us from his love. We're a royal priesthood. You who sit there, who have trusted Jesus Christ and the work God did in your life, are a royal priesthood. That is truth. You might recall that Jesus Christ says the truth will set you free. This is part of the freedom that we have when we meditate on verses and truths like this. Finally, let me remind you of Psalm 139. I know that last week was Sanctity of Life Sunday, I believe, right? So Psalm 139 talks beautifully about how God is the masterpiece and the master designer of who we are. Not just spiritually, I've talked about a salvation, but physically. This wondrous thing we call the body, the mind, the soul, the heart. God knit it all together while we are yet in the womb, correct? Psalm 139, 17 says this, "How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. If I would count them, they're more than the sand." That is how much God dotes on you, thinks about you, meditates upon you. God is a parent to us. Once we accept his work, not only is he responsible for the fact that we exist and the world we exist in, he's responsible for the redemption we have and salvation that I've explained, and then he goes on to parent us, coach us. He's a good master, the Bible tells us. He is the most perfect of all of these things. He will not quit. He will not abandon. He will not go too fast nor too slow. He will not make mistakes. He will not be outcoached. He will not draft the wrong people into your life. He will not get up too late or walk out to the stand too noisily. He will not dress inadequately for the weather. He will not fail to plan. He will not waste time at the water cooler or lean on the shovel and watch you do all the work. He is perfect. His plan is perfect. His ways are perfect. He is sovereign and he is in control. He has told us the plan like any good parent or coach. So this is God's work done. And he will continue to do it through us. Philippians 1:6 that I read says, "I am sure of this, that God who has begun a work in your life will see it through to the completion for the day of Jesus Christ." That means when Jesus returns. So what's the second part of this? Simply this, we must do what God has clearly given us to do. We have work to do. So God has done all the work that we can't do, and he will always do that. But he calls us to be about his business and do the work that we can do. Do you recall that I said that there were some slogans, some cliches in our culture? There is no such thing as a free lunch. Sounds too good to be true, it probably is. Nothing's as simple as it seems. You get what you work for. What I didn't say at the time is there's a lot of truth in these sayings. It's one of the reasons they became cliches. This is not contrary. Remember, one of my point today is there's no real conflict here. Only when you live on the extremes do we find conflict. You see, there's something else in God's scripture called the law of the harvest. And we know this by practical everyday living. If you do no work, you get no result. This is common sense. We don't have to think that God's work in salvation somehow flies in the face of the reality that he's called us to live through. Galatians 6:7 says this, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatever one sows, he will reap." There is no let go and let God through all circumstance. We cannot just sit back passively and let God do everything. He doesn't want to do it that way, and we're living according to his plan. Ephesians 2:8 through 10, a moment ago, I stopped at verse 9. I read 2, 8, and 9, which is often part of the evangelistic effort. Right? You want people to understand that it's not by works you're saved, which is what 2, 8, and 9 make clear. But here's what verse 10 says. "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus," that's physically created, then spiritually redeemed through salvation in Christ Jesus, "for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. There's no contradiction in Ephesians, like there's no contradiction in our lives. It tells us that we cannot be saved by good works, but that we are prepared for good works and called to those good works. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, "Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed." There is no conflict or tension here. In fact, what we find is that we must choose to live life righteously, to do good works, but it's only in His power that we can do these things. John 15:5, another passage that I'm sure that you've heard here and there, is where Jesus talks and He says that, "I am the vine and you are the branches. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Apart from me, you can do nothing." Let's remember not to take things out of context or too literally. All words that are spoken in a moment. They're to the right or left of another word. They're to an audience spoken by somebody in a moment in time. This is truth. And we can easily get a little turned around when we forget those things. There are people all over the world today accomplishing great things, building great cities, truly, genuinely helping their neighbors. People all over the world doing what we might say are good things, and they don't know Jesus Christ. That's not a contradiction. We are all human beings are made in God's image and have an immaterial nature that seeks Him, whether we consciously admit it or not. God has given us this ability to love. And in our free will, we can take that ability to love, and even as many of us have sometimes done, we can turn it into something different, something lesser. We can even turn it into something the opposite, like hate. And apart from Jesus Christ, we can do no good thing. We can do no work. So we have to remember the work we're talking about is contextualized. It's part of the good work as God defines good. We know this word love. In English, you know, I teach English, and we have one word in English that really means love, love. And that's it. And I have no other way to say it or spell it, L-O-V-E. And so it lands me in this awkward place where I say things like, "I love you, Bess. I do love my wife." And then I'll be at work and I'll say, "Oh, I love tennis. I like to play tennis. And I like basketball. I don't know if I love basketball, but I like basketball. I love pizza. I do love pizza." And we all really, especially my dear wife, hope that I mean different things by that word love, depending on who I'm talking to and what I'm talking about. You see, in the Greek language, they didn't have that limitation. They've got several different words that mean love. They've got several different words that mean a lot of different things, including salvation. You'll see later in Philippians 2:12, it says, "Work out your salvation with fear and trembling." Just a real quick note about that, lest we have that confusion and tension that we don't need to have. Salvation is a process with a past, a present, and a future. Think of it this way. I've been saved. I've trusted Jesus Christ, according to the Bible, to forgive me of my sins. That happened when I was 12 years old, over 40 years ago. That's a point in time that happened. And the Bible makes it clear that my forever, in fact, it was in part of what was in a hymn today or scripture that was read. We are, I believe it's part of Ephesians, yes. We are seated with Him in the heavenlies. It's a foregone conclusion, and God is outside of time and sees the whole picture, right? So there was a point at which I was saved, but then I'm being saved through this life, and I will be saved in the future when it's all said and done and the day of Jesus Christ is here. Furthermore, I have been saved, so what sense do we make of it when I suffer from a disease and die? I pray that I don't suffer in any terrible way, but this is the reality. In 50 years, I will not be here. Just add another couple years if I'm wrong, or take 40 away. That is the end, and that is the hopelessness of life without Christ. This flesh withers and fades. So then you might say, then what were you saved from or saved to? You see, salvation itself is not a simple word you can just kick around. Like, I can't just kick the word love around. So in Philippians 2:12, when he says, "Work out your salvation," he's talking in a context, and he's not contradicting himself and telling you have to work for salvation. He's telling you to do good works. to work out that salvation. Moving on. How does this process happen? You know, so we've got these two big ideas, that God did the work of salvation. There are certain things God does that we can't do, but then there is work that we have to do and that God calls us to do. And these are both true, and there is no tension or conflict. But how does this process happen? How am I, you know, especially if I'm somebody that I would say is most of the people in this sanctuary today doing the right thing in life, doing things well. You're here on a Sunday, spending your morning listening to God's word be shared. You sang and worshiped the Lord a moment ago in song. You're doing good things. How do we maintain this process? Remember John 15:5 that says, I'm the vine, you're the branches. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Well, I would suggest this. I shared this with the men a couple of weeks ago. It starts with the small things. You might recall that Jesus Christ says to us, take care of small little things, and I will give you more. What's the smallest thing I can take care of? And I don't mean small as in literal size, of course, but what's the basics? Where can I start? What do I truly have any control over? As I reflect on these things, it must start with my own heart. It starts with me and my response to God. You know, I get up in the morning and I head to work. You know, I teach in a classroom every day. And what I need to do is prepare for my day. You know, for my routine and rhythm of my life, it's a cup of coffee, some time in God's word, a shower, I get dressed, and I end up in the classroom an hour and a half later. I prepare for a successful day. So I would ask each of us, I'm not here to tell you what that looks like in your life, but if you want to partner with God and be a part of the branches on that vine, that's a good thing to want. All the blessings and the joy of living a life for Christ are for you now in this lifetime. They're for me now in this lifetime. I want part of that. I want to live a life that glorifies God. I want to live a life that is good. That's what I want to do in this lifetime. And I want to not be at war with myself in that effort. So what do I do? Well, fortunately, the answer is not complicated. I didn't say it's always easy, but it's not complicated. I need to be in God's word. He tells us that. Other sermons can address that, but all over. I need to read God's word. I need to be around other people that are like-minded. I can't forsake the fellowship of brothers and sisters in Christ. We are immersed in a world that doesn't love God, doesn't want God. We go every day to work to those places. I go to a public school that has tried mightily for 100 years now and counting to push God as far out of its walls as it possibly can. I fight that battle. We are not immersed in a culture that will rub God off on us. We're supposed to do the opposite. But the Bible makes it very clear. If you're going to do the opposite, if you're going to be the salt and the light, if you're going to carry your thoughts about a good and holy God, and you're going to do that work, you have to do it His way. Remember, He's the perfect coach and father and parent and master, and He's got a plan. So we're in His word. We're around His people. We soak that up. I begin every day reminding myself of His great love, the love that He has for me, which I highlighted for you earlier. Philippians 4:8. By the way, I love the book Philippians. I encourage all of you to read through it. I really do. In Philippians 4, it's not a central point of my message today, but Philippians 4:8 talks about if anything is good, if anything is true, noble, praiseworthy, noteworthy, anything at all excellent, and I'm paraphrasing here, think about those things, meditate on them, dwell on the good. How easy it is to dwell on the negative and the bad. How often we think about the one unanswered prayer and forget the 99 that are behind us, right? So Paul tells us again in Philippians to meditate on what is good and begin with the daily small things, and God will lead you into better and bigger things. What do I allow into my mind, in my eyes, in my ears? Do I redeem? Do I renew the mind, as Romans tells us? Or do I allow pollution into my heart and my soul that would tear me away from the Lord and His goodness? One of my favorite verses is Micah 6:8, and it says this: He has shown you, O man, what is good. Now, this is Old Testament, and I love to see the Old Testament and the New Testament just slide together because, hey, it's one book. And it is written by different men, but they were all guided by one Holy Spirit. And sometimes people will debate that, and they'll say, no, it wasn't. This guy wrote that, and that guy wrote that. Yeah, but God did it. Remember my whole thesis today? All God, but men cooperated? It's even in the writing of these words. He didn't need to do that. He just spoke all creation into existence, did he not? Did he need anybody with a printing press to give us this? No. But he wanted us to do it that way. He wants us in the effort. It's his plan. It has been from the beginning. So Micah 6:8, hundreds of years before the New Testament, says he is showing you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? And this is of us. But to do what is just, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. There you have it. What do they say today in high school? Mic drop or something like that? That's it. Do what is just, love mercy, and walk humbly with our God. And I want to remind myself of how that is so connected to John 15:5 with the vine and the branches. It's all tied together. It's not complicated, but I'm here to tell you, brothers and sisters, you pray for me and my family. We pray for yours. It's a journey, and it is not always easy. But at least I know what God wants me to do. The blessings, the joys, and the usefulness of our Christian life can only be known if we obey him and do these works. You may have heard a story of an elderly master carpenter. He was ready to retire. He told his employer, the home builder, that he was ready to retire, that he planned to leave the house building business and live a more leisurely life with his wife and enjoy his extended family. He would miss the paycheck and the money, but he had enough to retire, and that was more important. They would get by. The home builder, his boss, was sorry to see his good worker go, but asked him if he could build just one more house as a favor to him, as a personal favor. The carpenter thought about it. He finally relented and said, okay, I'll do it. After some time, though, it was easy to see that the carpenter's heart was not in his work. He was too focused on retirement. And he resorted to shoddy workmanship, and he used inferior materials, and he cut corners and rushed a little bit. It was, quite honestly, an unfortunate way to end his career. When the carpenter was done and the builder, the home builder, his boss, came to inspect the house, the boss handed the front door key to the carpenter. And he said, this is your house. It's my retirement gift for you. Sometimes I wonder about that in the Christian life we live. When I was 12, I trusted God for all the work he needed to do in my life that I couldn't do on my own, salvation. And at different times in my life since then, I'm guilty of some shoddy workmanship. I've had some ups and downs. There's been moments, years even in my life, where I didn't build well. God, in his faithfulness and in his grace, has reminded me over and over again, like that good coach, that good parent, like that good master, hey, Mark, let's get back on track. And my part of the work is to listen to that, because I've heard that and ignored it. I admit that to you. But then I've heard it and obeyed. And I have never, ever regretted that step of obedience. When you hear that whisper in your heart, and God is saying, he says it through family, he says it through messages, he says it through radio programs, he says it through his spirit directly into your heart. And he's calling you back to a better way of building. He is our masterpiece. I'm sorry. He is our designer and our builder. We are his masterpiece. But we have to make a choice to be his workmen. So let's do the work, sometimes the hard work, to grow in Christ-likeness. It's all about this, essentially. I can be better. Again, language can be confusing. I think I'm a good dad. I think I'm a good teacher. When I coach, I think I'm a good coach. I'm a good friend to people. I don't doubt that. I don't stand up here to be prideful about it, but knowing what you are and are not is part of the truth that sets you free. God's not looking for a false sense of piety. He's not looking for you to beat yourself up. And I give glory to God for making me good at those things. But I know this too. I can be better. And I don't mean a better driven by some kind of insecurity or performance-based need to prove to other people. I just know. And I give his credit, I give credit to his Holy Spirit. He's got that call. This is how you get a Paul who writes the New Testament, half of it, and then says, I'm at war with myself. The things I want to do, I don't do. The things I shouldn't do, I do. I am the chief of sinners. This is David. He slayed the giant, and then he killed Uriah. This is the battle of this life. So don't be surprised by it, to hear somebody, not a conflict. I'm a good dad. I could be a better dad. And it's not because I'm beating myself up. It's God's call on my every day is to get up and say, okay. I mean, we prize this in our athletics, right? Bigger, better every day. Education, we strive. If you read back through, please read back through Philippians and notice all the times that he says, Philippians and Ephesians and Timothy and many of these epistles are all about a call to strive, to work, to chase, to run the race. A lot of metaphors that say, go after it. What is it we're going after? The best version of us that we can be for a holy God that loves us. And we do it because he loved us first. John tells us that. We do it out of a compassion for him, a love for him. 1 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians 5:14 says, the love of Christ constrains or compels us. That's our motivation. The work God's already done motivates us to do the work every day and better that we can do. I want to stop and end by saying this as I close. Masterpieces are not created overnight. You know, in the animal world, Norm would teach me this. My wife and the fact that we have a bunch of goats in our yard teach me this. Some of the goats are about to have kids, they call them. I've got kids. With those baby goats, I had to have Olivia remind me. I think she told me, what is it, 30 minutes or so? They're born and 30 minutes later they're walking around? 2 minutes? Okay, it's instantaneous, okay? They're up, they're walking. The animal world is amazing. It's God's creation, the same designer. We take a while. We take a while. We just had a baby dedication. There's little May Lou. Can she walk? No, not yet. Okay. She can be cute, though. So the point is this. God's creating a masterpiece in us. He created the masterpiece, as you reflected on last week, physically, the physical world. The spiritual world, the made in his image part, he's at work, and it takes a while. I believe in his wisdom, that's part of why human children are not that independent that quickly. So be encouraged. God is still at work in you, as Philippians 1:6 shares. And he will not stop, and he will not quit, and he will not tire, and he will not look away, and he will not love you any less when you fight against him. It's not going to happen because he's God. We're his masterpieces, and masterpieces take a while. So be patient with yourself, but always wake up and be determined. I'm going to do that work today. I'm going to start with the small things in my own heart, and then I'm going to look for other ways that you'll use me. Many of you are there, teaching VBS, serving in Sunday school, making the coffee, stacking the tables and chairs, and you grow. And this was not something I was doing when I was 12, and I wasn't doing it when I was 25, and I wasn't doing it when I was 35, but here I am today doing it. And I'm looking for all different shapes, sizes, and ways and manner by which I can serve my Lord and Savior, and I love doing it. And I'll tell you what, he'll bring a joy and a usefulness into your Christian walk that you have never experienced before. Even if yesterday was great, tomorrow can be just mind-blowing. So my prayer to you is that you would trust in God for the work only he can do and for the work he calls you to be a partner in. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you, Lord, for your amazing truth that as the Lord Jesus Christ said, does indeed set us free. I thank you, Lord, that I am free from the burden of the work I cannot accomplish, but that I am also called. I'm given the offer, the job offer, to work alongside you to build the best me that you can build, and then to be used by you to go out and build your kingdom. Lord, this this place, this Lindenville, this Barker, this Western New York, my block, my school, my kids, we all need you, whether we realize it or not, and you want us to help with that. I am so privileged to be loved by you, to be called by you to be a part of that. And I ask, Lord, your blessing on my life and on my brothers and sisters here, that as we respond to your great love for us, Lord, we would do so in a way that is honoring and glorifying to you and also good for us. We thank you and we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Let's turn to number 83 as we close our service with a song. There's something about that name. Number 83. Thankful for his willingness to yield and to serve you and to share the truth. And we pray that we might now go in peace to love and serve our Lord Jesus Christ. For it's in his name we praise you. Amen.